Hey, it's Arroe. PodFest brings together three different conversations, from musicians to authors, doctors, environmentalists, or cooks in their own kitchen. These are real people with real stories. PodFest 62, we kick things off with an unforgettable singer, songwriter, and actress, Queen Latifah. Then we're stepping up the tempo while stepping back to a conversation I once shared with Spider from the group Powerman 5000. Our third conversation is all about the laughs, the one and only Rachel Feinstein. This is PodFest 62. First, the trailer to star on Fox. And then when we come back, we'll be unplugged and totally uncut with Queen Latifah.
Ever since Star was little, she believed her name was who she was. But I told her, fame is a trip. It ain't love like a lot of people think. But she wouldn't listen. I think
of time. You've been through 6 foster families in the last 2 years. You're a thief, habitual liar.
You think it's any easier on the outside? Do you even have anywhere to go? I'm
still waiting for. First thing I'm gonna do is go get my sister.
It took 5 years for your ass to show up.
You used to say we were gonna be famous.
You still sing?
Yeah, I still sing.
I got a plan.
I dream of a day. I met this girl on Instagram. She grew up in foster care, and everything she's been through is in her voice. And we need to get in the studio.
So you want me to open up your trust fund for some white trash you met on the internet?
I need to make music that feeds my soul.
Damn, girl. You're straight off a page of Vogue.
We're gonna start in Atlanta.
Where we gonna live?
There's this lady named Miss Carlotta. She's been writing letters to social services saying she's our godmother.
She's been looking for you and your sister a long time.
Cause just when I was about to give up, I heard Jesus say, change gonna come one day.
We heard Atlanta has a crazy music scene and we're starting a girl group.
Your mother and I had the same dream. I'm trying to keep you from getting hurt.
I can't get hurt anymore. You know exactly what I've been through.
The minute I heard that girl sing, it made me feel we got the makings of a super group. It is what you see.
Stay away from those girls.
Who shot ya? Who knocked ya? We gotta stick together. Go to these people, they don't know anything.
You know it's late today.
Here we are.
That butt looks good.
It does.
Good morning, Queen Latifah. How are you doing today?
I'm good, Al. How are you doing?
Doing very well. You have to sit back and look at this show and realize that The Sound of Music is what listeners imagine, and Star on Fox has just turned it into a reality.
Oh, my goodness. That's an interesting way of putting it. We go there with the music. The music is a big, big part of this show and the fantasy ideas of it and just taking it different places every single week. So it's just a lot of fun. It's a lot of work and it's a lot of fun.
And yet you have lived the journey. And now that you're on a show like this, it's almost like you're giving we on this side of the flat screen the opportunity to even though it is a fantasy, it's still it can become our reality.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's definitely a life that a lot of us have lived on. I've lived it. But watching these girls kind of start off and be so hungry for fame and success and making it in the business and, you know, how far Star is willing to go for it, you know, how far all the girls are willing to go or not go for it is something that I've known since I was a kid, since I was their age. So it's just kind of, it's almost like art is imitating life every week, watching people trying to make it. Of course, we got some juicy stuff too. You know, people die, people lie. We want you to feel like you're living it with us every time you watch this show. So thank you. That means we're delivering on these performances.
When you do bring these scenes together, and even while you're performing, do you feel the legends of music just right there beside you? Because the way that you're delivering these lyrics and the songs that you're performing, come on, this is serious R&B.
Yes, it is. We have some great producers and writers. It's crazy how we even are able to pull this stuff off. And it's kind of fun for us to watch the show, too, because we all shoot at different times. And then we finally get, when the show comes on, we finally see what everybody has been doing. Even though we've read the script, but to actually watch it come to life is like an unbelievable treat for us as well. So, and we do have some R&B legends that actually are in the show, you know, like Gladys Knight, who's a guest in the show. So it's kind of fun to see people that you love and you know, and have them become part of this journey.
Wouldn't you say that Star on Fox is a TV show about connection and how to reconnect when you think that it's gone?
I think that's part of it. I think part of it is about love.
Yes.
Everyone has a love for something. Carlotta has a love for these kids, and she wants redemption. She wants to, you know, kind of rewrite. She can't rewrite history, but she can rewrite the future. I mean, she can kind of change the future, and she really wants to do that. These girls have a love of music and a love, a desire for success, so they're going for it in every kind of way. You know, some just want to live life and enjoy it without being under the pressure of their parents. It's you know, Cotton wants to be accepted for Cotton. So everybody has something that they're going for in here.
Is there a side of you inside of Cotton? Because I was that disc jockey that played your first record, and I knew that you just wanted to be you when you were on that single.
Yeah. So it's so weird being in this show sometimes and watching how things that I've been through are you know, kind of injected into the script. But that's some of the stuff that Lee and I talked about from the very beginning, and he's real open to finding real life stories that match what's happening in these scripts, because it just grounded in real life. And of course, I just wanted to be me, but that was hard. It wasn't easy to be me, but what I sounded like, what I wanted to say was different than what people were doing at the time, you know? So it's hard to be a trendsetter, but if you really want to, you have to. You have no choice. You have to go for it.
And yet this show on Fox Star, it has that trend-setting ability, because I can't imagine how many imaginations are going to watch this show and create their own music on this side of it.
Well, Fox is a brave network to create shows like they do. And I know for a fact that there are people out there who are watching this show thinking, we can do this. We can be that girl group. We can sing better than them. We can dance better. You know, it's just that competitive juice just comes into people. And I got a feeling we're going to start seeing a lot more girl groups. I think that this show can actually help make that happen. My friends say that I'm crazy. I'm crazy, girl. 'Cause I give you my love. Ooh, but you're my little sexy baby. You do it to me good.
And it kind of showcases some girl power, doesn't it? It really kind of says, hey, look, this isn't just a man's world, the music industry.
Oh, absolutely not. It definitely shows some girl power. And it's not, you know, the music industry is not. I mean, I know a lot of, I was signed by a woman, you know, at Tommy Boy. And there's a bunch of women in this industry who are very powerful and have created a lot of great music. I mean, you can take it back to Suzanne DePass. So there's a lot of powerful women in this industry, and we're going to show that these girls can do it too. You know that I ain't playing.
Do you you find that there's going to be a soundtrack that's going to come from this? Because, I mean, just the development of the whole storyline is we're going to get, you know, let's call a spade a spade. It's almost like watching professional wrestling. We see the struggles, we see the challenges, but man, it has become a soundtrack to our life.
Definitely. I mean, some of the songs are already out. So I know a lot of people, from what I look at, when I look at Twitter sometimes after the show or when it's happening, people are already looking forward to hearing the new songs, or they've heard some of the songs, they've gone to iTunes, or, you know, they've gone to online and listened to the songs that are on the show, and they get to hear them, and they're looking forward to what is coming out next week already. So I'm definitely seeing a response.
What is that like for you, being the music professional that you are, that in the day that when you first came out, we had to wait for that 45 or that album, but now it's so readily available?
I mean, I think it's, I do miss that you would kind of crave those things, but I love that you can actually get it right away. You can just go and listen to a song that just played on TV, you know, and really enjoy it right then and there. I think that's kind of fun. And it also keeps us on our toes because we can make new music quick and get it out there as quickly as we want to. It was not that easy back in the day.
Driving by the park tonight, I was stopping at the light, and it reminded me of all those days. Posted at the coffee shop, we would sit and talk for hours. Never thought in a million things would change.
What is it like for you, being the creative mind that you are, that we are in a new age of television where quality from Fox is just driving the ship right now because it puts you at a different level?
Well, I think I'm very thankful for Fox for even taking this chance on this show. I think it's a wonderful thing. And we push ourselves just as hard. We won't let the bar lower, because we want the best and we want to create the best TV, and we think people deserve to see it. And Lee's mind is so very creative that we really want to execute those ideas and make sure that they happen, because there's things that come on Star that you've never seen on television before. So we like the idea of being able to offer the audience something new and something titillating, you know, because they often too many times gotten the same old thing, boring TV, yep. You know, and, you know, TV is so hot right now, so Fox is rolling.
I can see a Golden Globe being placed in your hands, girl.
Well, I could definitely add another one to my trophy kick. Thanks, Arrow.
Unplugged and totally uncut with Spider from Powerman 5000. I love to get inside the head and heart of those that bring music to life, because I believe that listeners, they get their interpretation and it's like, wow, that's just not fair to the artist. Or is it fair to you guys?
That's it's so weird that you just said that. I'm gonna tell you why, because I was just thinking about something right before I called you, and because we had just put out this video we made for the song Cult Leader, right?
Yeah.
And so I noticed a few, like, let's say, not negative comments, but comments saying, like, wow, it's so repetitive, it's weird. And I thought, well, yeah, like, doesn't that make perfect sense? Because the idea of, you know, getting sucked into a cult is this hypnotic, you're put into this hypnotic state and you're fed these, you know, these sort of lines over and over, and like these mantras. And so I thought, like, to me, that idea of this sort of repetitive chant-like song made perfect sense with the subject matter, but apparently not to anyone who listened to it.
I wanna be your cult leader. Tie you to the bed, fuck you up in the head. You be the needle, I'll be the thread. God bless the kids, God bless the beast. God bless the liars, the dead and the cheats. I wanna be
in a situation like that where it's like you just want to write to him in a way and say, hey, look, here's the situation? Or do you think it, or is it like, I see a pink elephant? All right, you see a pink elephant. Do you have to let them go their own way?
Yeah, of course. Look, at the end of the day, you just sort of make something and you throw it out there and send it on its way. It's like having a kid and you send it to school and hopefully, you know, they navigate the waters and don't become the school bully or the asshole or whatever. But you know, I think that, but then because we live in such a climate where there is such, you know, back and forth communication with, you know, fans, for lack of a better word, whatever, you know, so you're sort of seeing all this commentary and you're, you know, your gut instinct is to like write to everybody like, no, you got that wrong. But you can't, like, once you start the, you know, you can't even begin that conversation because it just, that would be a full-time job, just like discussing what you meant and what you didn't mean. And so, but I mean, you know, that is the beauty of music or anything else, is really it is meant to sort of be processed in a million different ways and not just the way you intended it to be.
Well, you guys have kind of grown up right through that internet age, because I mean, when you guys first appeared on the scene, I mean, people were sending emails and maybe letters. They weren't getting that instant satisfaction from Facebook and Instagram and all that.
Yeah, no, I mean, we definitely in bands of our, you know, time period of definitely, I think it's like we almost have the strangest experience in music, because you've spent a good portion of your career pre-internet or whatever, whatever, yeah, you want to, however you want, and then post. And so they really have been two like extremely different environments to make music and to release music, whether it be how it's perceived or how it's consumed or how it's sold or not sold. And so, yeah, it's been a really, like, it, you know, you never want to not face forward and face the future and sound like the old guy still, like, well, when we recorded on tape, it was, you know, I never want to be that guy, you know, because people look at you like, you know, like a dog that just heard a high pitched noise, like you're insane. But, so yeah, it's been, but you have to like adjust, but then there are things that you know, you miss about the way it was. And then there are things that you're like, can't believe how great the way it is. And so, yeah, it's you know, it's a unique place to be for sure.
Well, I got to talk to you about the energy of the song, Thank God. Were you thinking of Sam Kinison while putting this song together?
No, I wasn't, but I could see what you're saying, because it's just complete. Yeah, I think we actually filmed me singing it, so it was just me, you know, without the music. It was, it's like the ugliest thing you ever heard in your life. It's just because I just wanted to make, you know, because this record sort of goes all over the map, you know, and I just thought it would be just really fun to just do, you know, like, you know, 1 minute blast of pure noise. And so, you know.
But see, that's what makes it fun, because that reminds me of the old album days where everybody had their favorite cut on the album. And then you would spend hours explaining to people why that was the one place to go to.
Yeah, for sure. Look, I mean, speaking of like, you know, now versus then, I mean, I definitely still live in the album sensibility. You know what I mean? Like, I still think about how it flows and this and that, and not just, you know, what are the singles going to be or what, you know, I can't wrap my head around that at this point, you know, I grew up listening to albums, and, yeah, you know, I also grew up listening to albums when they were short. So, you know, they were 35 minutes and you wanted to listen to it three times in a row. And yeah, the single was generally never your favorite song, you know? When I bought Combat Rock by The Clash, I'd skip over Rock the Casbah because, yeah, I heard that enough and I wanted to hear Overpowered by Funk or Ghetto Defendant. You know, that was to me like the cooler shit. You know, I was like, that's the stuff I want to listen to. You know,
I heard it's a god awful small affair, burning bright but never anywhere. So let's dance like with David fucking Bowie. Come on, come on. Take a look, see the mice in a million hordes. Celebrate as they fall on the swords. So let's dance like with David fucking Bowie. Come on.
How much fun did you guys have putting together David fucking Bowie? Seriously.
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the first songs we did for the record. And, you know, clearly, what, you know, the passing of Bowie was like a big deal for me, because, you know, even though, you know, we don't make music anywhere near the level of David Bowie, or, you know, it was just, you know, for me growing up, you know, punk rock was a huge influence, and David Bowie and like, isn't certainly not punk rock, but he embodied the spirit of just, you know, he was one of those guys that I would just look to and be like, and I still try to hold at least the attitude of just like, I don't care. Like, I want to do whatever I want to do and however I want to do it. And, you know, and he was the king of that. And he was like, you know, and it's just, you know, I just don't see those kind of people existing in music today, certainly not in rock music. You know, it's just like rock music has become so conservative, yeah. You know, and not only conservative sonically, but conservative, like, in its politics and its philosophy. And it's just, it's very strange to me. Sometimes I feel like such an outsider in, you know, in the workplace, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but isn't that what punk rock is supposed to be about? Because I've been with all the members of the Sex Pistols except for Sid Vicious, and they all told me it was about rebellion. It's all about what we were feeling in that moment.
Oh, well, that's what it always should be about. I mean that's the only point to it, to me, in a way, is like to try to make something that horrified your parents, you know what I mean? Like, 'cause, you know, that was me. Like, I can't even imagine, you know, what my parents thought when I was, you know, 13 years old and blasting, you know, Sex Pistols and Minor Threat and Black Flag from my bedroom. And they were just probably hearing it going, we've failed completely. Like, he's out of his mind, you know? Yeah, I was going to say, but, you know, unfortunately, I think we hear more and more, you know, and I'm certainly not in the business of, like, ever talking publicly about any specific bands, but I just see what's out there, and I don't get it. Like, I just feel like there's this real sense of safety, and, you know, and I think a lot of it is because there's, you know, the money, making a lot of money in music is sort of, at least for rock bands, has kind of been taken off the table, you know. So so I think everybody's just scrounging for crumbs, and they feel like, well, we've got to, you know, get on the radio, and we've got to get on this playlist on Spotify, and we've got to do this. And so everyone just kind of stays in the slow lane, you know, whereas I think before there was a freedom where, you know, and again, not to talk about the old days, but when we got signed, like, there's no way we would ever get signed to a major label today. No. Oh, wow. Way. Like, we were the weird, like, when we first started out, we were just this, had no idea. And I had no knowledge of business or the music. I didn't know what an A&R guy was. I didn't know anything. We were just like a bunch of dummies. Like, can we write a song? Like, you know, and we were just, I like rap. I like punk rock. I like this. Just make this big mess of a, but, you know, but then I look back and I'm like, well, those are the bands that were getting shot. You know, when we got signed to DreamWorks, you know, who was getting signed to Geffen was like Sonic Youth.
Yes.
Beck, the Butthole Surfers, like all these bands that just, there's no way today that they would even be looked at, you know? So, I just miss that spirit of, just, like I said, just not caring, you know, not, you know, and also not being, you know, I think everyone's like, I'm always shocked at how many bands are like very, like, right wing, you know, guns and Trump. And it's just like, really? Like, I mean, that's fine, but like, you're in a band, like, you're supposed to be the other side of the, you know, of the line.
Everything you do is so fucked up, but that's the reason that I'm stuck.
The I don't care attitude, it rests in the title Sid Vicious in a Dress, because that seems to be something that he'd say, I don't care. I just don't care.
Well, I probably, like, to my detriment, not cared enough. And, you know, I probably would be a lot further along in life if I cared more. But I mean, this Sid Vicious in a Dress was, you know, look, the fact is, for that, the funny thing about that song, and it's funny that it ended up being the first single, is it was the last song we wrote for the record. So basically, I was like, we have this record done. We're good. Like, we can put this out. But hey, let's just do one more for fun. And as usual, that's generally ends up being like the song. It's like, hey, this is the best one, because the pressure's off, you know. But as far as conceptually, I had that song title in my phone for like 2 years. Just
wow.
I wrote it down and I thought to myself, like, this might be too literal for Powerman, because we've always been a little bit more abstract, and you know, we've always been like a, you know, a weird science fiction movie. We're actually commenting on politics and society, but, you know, we're disguising it with robots and laser beams. So, like, you can actually get away with it without people saying, shut up, don't talk about that, just make music. So I was like, this song feels like Sid Vicious in a Dress. It feels like I'll write this song for somebody else, because it just feels like too, like I said, too literal, too straight ahead, like you get what it means. It's about a crazy girl, you know? And so, but then it just kept sticking with me, and then I was like, I'll give it a shot, and ended up like just loving it. And, you know, and I think it had, you know, I'm sure that if Johnny Lydon heard it, he would say I was a piece of shit and it's terrible. And, you know, but I would completely take that as a badge of honor, and, you know.
Yeah. Cause you don't want him to like it. You want him to be able to sit there and fire off that mouth of his.
Oh yeah, no. I would love for him to just hear it and just talk about what a waste of life I am. Yeah, but I was gonna say the one last thing. I do think that I also grew, most of my favorite bands are English, and you know, and I do mm-hmm. think that's the one thing that they have that we lack in American bands is a sense of humor, you know, and like being, you know, not being like a joke band, but having a real like odd sense of humor. And I think that, like, if there's one thing that song, it just in the title itself, has is like, you know, a sense of humor about it that hopefully translates to people. I don't know.
I'll tell you what, you just nailed it on the head there with the British and with that kind of style, because there is so much attitude in their music. And this new album proves it, because you're going along, you're head banging, you're getting into everything, the anthem-esque of footsteps, and then along comes No White Flag, and you're going, whoa.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I mean, look, I, you know, sometimes you'd question like, oh, does this make sense? Should we do this? But then that's probably the reason why you should put it out. Like, if you're questioning it, if you're like, this song, I don't know, man, like, people might not dig this. And then that's probably like reason number one to put it out. So we did that song. And yeah, it's clear for people who haven't heard it yet. It's like super mellow and has like orchestration on it. And it's just, you know, like, but at the end of the day, it's like, throw it out there. And a lot of times those left of center songs that we put on a record always become like fan favorites. Yeah. You know, people like totally dig it.
Listening. Are you afraid to be your own enemy? Think you surrender, please. Are you afraid to be your own enemy? Broken, bloody knees. No, that ain't me. That ain't me.
Does it scare you at all that with a song like No White Flag, that all of a sudden you could kick off a whole new metal love song era of music again?
I don't think there's any chance of that happening. But
wouldn't it just scare the hell out of you? I was like, damn it.
Yeah, it's like our Home Sweet Home. And like, yeah. All of a sudden we're like I never was planning on playing this live ever. Now I have to play it. Yeah, there are songs like that. Like we do a song like that. I'm like, I'll never play this live. So whatever, you know, I don't have to worry about it. But yeah, then suddenly it becomes like your anthem, you know, song, and you're on the Tonight Show struggling through it, you know.
Well, it's funny how people associate your band right away with video games. And is that an area that you want to be known for, or how do you want those fans to discover you?
Yeah, I mean, look, I don't play video games. I don't know much about them, but I mean, from the very beginning, you know, we were always open to, you know, I always thought, like, however somebody finds out about the band, what difference does it make? What, you know, what is there more validity to the radio, find someone hearing the radio or hearing it on a video game? No, what difference does it make? They hear it, they like it,
yeah.
And hopefully they come see us. So, you know, I remember there was a time where bands were very precious about what they licensed their songs to. You know, they always were waiting for that particular movie or that. And from the beginning, we told, when we were, you know, back in the day, we just said, anything, anywhere, anytime. You know, I don't care. I mean, as long as it wasn't something that I found like morally offensive, you know. So we would just, any movie that wanted a song, like, yep, put it in there. Any video game, yep, put it in there. Because my feeling was like, you know, and at the end of the day, I probably get more people telling me that they discovered this band on Tony Hawk, you know, video game, or like the Little Nicky soundtrack, or, you know, Jason versus Freddy. Like, so to me, I guess it was the right call, you know, because it doesn't matter. Like, it's all discovery, you know. I mean, I discovered bands in HBO where there was like, you know, they would play videos between movies. I was like, that was sort of some of my favorite bands I found then. Like, so there's no wrong or right way to discover a band, for sure.
How do you like the way they're discovering bands these days? They're jumping onto the SoundClouds. They're going to the iTunes. And what they're doing is, or the thing that I always keep hearing, they'll go to Google and they'll just put in awkward words because somewhere along the line, it's going to lead them to music.
That's amazing. I haven't tried that one. But I mean, again, like I say, like there's no wrong way. Like, we can sit here and go, oh, remember the days we'd go to the record store and flip through and find a cool album cover. And like, yeah, like that was cool because it's, you know, it's not necessarily a better way of discovering. I just think that the advantage to discovering something the old way was that it took energy and effort and money.
Yep.
So maybe you valued it a little bit more, you know, because I remember that, like, you'd have to find a way to get to the store if you didn't already drive. So you like take the bus or, you know, ride your bike or get, you know, beg your parents to drive you. And so then you had to go to the record store, flip through this, you know. And so, you know, you couldn't even listen to it. You get home until you open it and, you know, all this kind of stuff. So, like, I do feel like there was anything that takes a little effort, you're going to hold a little more, you know, dearly and value more. So I think that there's some advantage to that than just, you know, pressing play, you know. So, but, you know, again, that doesn't mean that it can't be just, you know, affect you just as much and, you know, discovering it any way you can, really. And we have to, and that's the thing, like, you got to be everywhere.
Yep.
Because, you know, as many ways as there are to discover there is to discover music, it feels like everyone's missing it somehow.
Run, run, run for your life before it's too late.
We're getting ready to go on tour, and I think about this all the time when we go on tour, because there was a time when you'd have to buy the Boston Phoenix or LA Weekly or whatever, and you'd look in the concerts. Oh, okay, cool. Powerman's playing at the Whiskey. I'm going to go to that.
Yep.
But now, like, tour dates are everywhere. And even, like, you know, I see it every day. We'll have here are the tour dates, guys. And you have it on Facebook and clearly list that on the 3rd, we're going to be in whatever, Idaho Falls, right? You know, and the first comment is, when are you guys coming to Idaho Falls? So no one, you know, so it's like this weird thing where the information's everywhere, but no one's actually paying attention to it.
That's
so
right.
We've got to get people to actually focus a little bit.
They're going to find you. Voices. You hear voices. You hear calling. They got you crawling. 3:45, still staring at the ceiling. Locked up tight, but still you got that feeling. You're not alone. There's someone in your home. They're breathing down your neck. They're tapping in your phone, right? Ring, ring.
some conspiracies, they all come and drop now.
What is the best place for someone to find out more about the new tour and the new album? Where can people go?
I mean, everything's online. You know, we try to be as up to date as possible on, you know, the website and Facebook and all that stuff. So it's you know, I think that honestly is the best. But you actually, you know, you have to go. You actually have to read the information, and you know.
We are unplugged and totally uncut with Rachel Feinstein.
Can I curse on here?
Absolutely.
Okay, good. That's good to know. Jesus fucking Christ. It's been an exhausting morning. I just did an abortion joke on the, I don't know. It was one of the morning news shows, and no one knew what to say. It got weirdly quiet.
Is that awkward silence?
They asked me if I had any kids, and I said I was pregnant, but not for long. yeah. And then they just they didn't have enough things to cut to in the studio. Everybody was just looking around what the hell?
Like a microphone that can't stay up.
I know, right?
We do all these commercials for these men's things. You can get it back up, but we can't keep our microphone up.
Oh, God, it's so good to be here.
For you to go from morning show to morning show to morning show, that's got to be hell on you.
It is, but then when I come to someplace like this and you tell me I can curse and then I feel like nobody's going to judge my abortion jokes, then I just feel at home all of a sudden, you know? Sometimes it's fun, but sometimes, you know, people look at you like you're a weird, suspicious, out-of-town whore, and they don't know what you're up to. Yeah. One fun-loving abortion joke, for crying out loud. Who's that going to kill?
But doesn't it feel good, though, to be able to step into the shoes of any actress you want to be at that time? So, in other words, I'd be the guy that would be sitting in a car going, I think today I'm going to become this guy when I walk in the studio, and you stay in character.
You're right. I think that's a good idea. I should do that. I should just go on, fully and fully commit to something completely insane one morning. That would be fun, because there's something about those morning TV programs where everything's just this is clean and life is clean. You just want to be fuck you. No, it's not. Cunt, 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 cunt. You know?
See, you talk like the way I drive through Charlotte. It's like, what the hell are you doing over there? God! It's like these people that walk alongside the highway. I don't get it, man.
Yeah.
You're going to get killed.
I know. It's very strange. It's very suspicious.
So I always look at them as being ghosts, that they're not really there, that somebody just happened to walk by me.
I know. I've always went, people walking on a highway, nothing's good. There can't be a good tale behind that, for sure. Yeah. I'm on the road a lot, so I watch way too much Forensic Files.
really?
Yeah. I'm completely obsessed. I think it's because it makes you feel like an amazing person. Like, if you watch a lot of Law and Order back to back, you'll really think you're running a tight ship in your life, you know? I'll be 4 in the afternoon, I'm just lying on my stomach the other day, and I was just stuffing what was it? Was it pound cake? No, I think it was a Pop-Tart in my face, and I was watching Law and Order, and I actually stopped and had this thought. I was like, I'm a good person. I don't have the slightest desire to kill prostitutes. It's never occurred to me. I run a tight ship in my life. I never had to frantically clean up blood spatter after a prostitute incident. Because you watch those shows and you're like, oh my God. And I'll watch them and I'm like, I'm a fine human being. I really am. Compared to everybody else. You ever give yourself credit for something you should obviously?
Oh, man, I'm in radio. You have to, because nobody else in this building is going to give me credit. That people will go, it's like people will come in and they'll go, hey, I need your expertise. Why am I here if I don't already bring it, man? Go on, what do you mean you need my expertise? It's like, hey, funny girl, tell me a joke. It's like, what?
I know. They do act like you're kind of like a dancing clown sometimes, you know? Yeah, just like, hey, dude, you're a jack in the box. Do a little jig for me. I'm like, all right, I'll do one.
When you hit that stage, do you feel like that you've been shot out of a box?
That's an interesting. I've never been out. Let me stop and think about that question. Not exactly. I kind of slide on more. Yeah, Late Show. It's like I sort of smear on. If that was a verb I could actually use, it would make sense. You know what I mean? Yeah. No, I've never. I don't feel like I've been shot out of something exactly. Although that seems like a fun thing to do. I wouldn't mind being lowered on stage. That would be fun if I was just slowly lowered. Like they attach some thin ropes.
That little thing that makes you pop up, man. Whoa, what the hell? Here I am now. Ta-da! That'd be so cool. And then if you stumble and stuff, everybody's got it on film, you know? It's like, yeah!
Yeah, being lowered or being, yeah, just popping up. There's something foolish about both of those things. You know, it's just, I wouldn't be able to do it without laughing in a way.
It just shows how Howard Stern was ahead of his time when he came in as Fartman. Are you old enough to remember that?
No, I mean, I probably am, but I don't know that specific thing, but please tell me more.
It was on the MTV Music Awards.
Uh-huh.
And he comes, they lower him down in this big old Fartman. He wanted it to be a superhero. And I just sat there watching going, I want to be him. That guy is so cool.
Yeah, it's fun. Being lowered is just silly. You know, there's just something hysterical about it. I still laugh at like really simple things. Like when I was a kid, I loved it when I'd watch a movie and somebody would be kicked out of a party, but they'd continue to try to enter. Like they just keep coming back in through a variety of entrances. And that still makes me laugh to this day. Someone that's told very clearly to leave and they're like, yeah, it's me again. Guess what?
Then yeah. You're going to love this new movie Inside Out then.
Really?
Because it opens up with, it's all the different moods, and they're inside this girl's head. It's animated. Mm-hmm. And one of them is sadness. Well, sadness is always touching all the other moods. Mm-hmm. And I literally wanted to stand up and go, God, get that sadness out of here. It's killing me. She's always, it's like, how many times do we have to tell you? Oh, my God. It was driving me insane. But there's a moral to the story, but it's like, oh, my God. So you're that type of person that keeps coming back?
I'd like to think I'm not that person that's been told to leave and keeps coming back, but I do think it's hysterical when it happens. There was a guy in one of my shows once that was kicked out and he kept re-entering, you know? He was really drunk and he was kicked out. This is like it's a club. It's not even open anymore. It was in Roswell, Georgia. And they, maybe somebody, that maybe you can remember, but it was in Roswell, Georgia. Oh, I think it was called something Farm, maybe Comedy Farm or Funny Farm, maybe? Yeah, Funny Farm. Yeah, in Roswell, Georgia. And it's totally closed down now, but they would give you go-kart tickets if you had a good show. You basically got tipped and free go-kart rides. How sad is that?
Oh my God.
Can you believe I haven't taken my own life yet? Yeah, he gave me 10 go-kart tickets as a reward for doing good funny times. Here's some go-kart tickets, you moron. good skits. I liked your talent show. Why don't you go ride in the go-kart? But this guy kept getting kicked out of my show there. He was really drunk, and he was so drunk that he was kind of like wet, you know, when somebody's like that. Yeah. He was just like shining, and yeah. And they'd been told to leave, and then he just kept coming back in through some sort of side entrance, like, hey, it's me.
Oh my God, that's like sneaking into a baseball game. That's a cool thing. And then you sit there and go, man, how's he getting in? I want to try this.
I know. And I know I should have been disturbed because it was definitely probably alarming, and there's no green room, and he was just kind of like glaring a little bit at me. But it was so funny that I couldn't get that mad. Yeah.
I mean, it's like in every radio station, there's always a place where the jocks can get into the building because we would sneak out and do things while the records and the CDs and stuff would play.
Really? Like, but what? What would you do? That's fascinating.
Oh, man. I've dug a hole here. Oh, man. Hello? Yeah. Okay, I'll be outside in 5 minutes. And so, yeah, you go outside and you play and have fun. And we would grab albums and throw them out in the field and see how far you could throw them. We would do everything outside.
Interesting.
And so before there was this thing called voice tracking, we would sit there and pre-record the show, mm-hmm. tape it up, and then run outside and play for an hour, hour and a half.
That's awesome.
And so then this way we didn't have to show up for the show.
Did you ever have a situation where you didn't get back in time?
Yes.
And what happened? Was it just air?
It was, well, you have the dead air.
Yeah.
And then that to me to this day still freaks me out.
Really?
Just the slightest bit of dead air.
Yeah.
And so, and I think it goes back to those days where the program director said, if I hear it once, that means that phone's going to ring. And so,
did it ring?
Yeah. Yeah. When I was locked out, I was locked out. The engineer had to come and let me back in.
Oh, you got locked out of the
building? Oh, yeah. Out of the building.
Yeah.
And so then you have to come up with a damn good lie as to why you were outside the building.
And what did you say?
I said I had to go out and plug my car in, man. It was wintertime.
Uh-huh.
It's up in Montana. When it gets cold, you plug your car in so that it doesn't freeze over. But that's not really why I was out there. So
no.
So it's, I mean, do you do anything like that?
Do they believe you?
Well, they had to.
How long was it just up with nothing?
Well, by the time the engineer got there on a cold night, probably about 35, 40 minutes, dead air.
Oh, my God.
So then you get the threats of, you know, we're not going to pay you for that time because you weren't on the air. I know.
What happened? Did you get scolded or was it just
no,
like,
it just,
not
you
really?
No, from the general manager, they look at you weird and they try to figure out what you're really up to.
Were you doing drugs?
No.
women? What was it? That was that.
See, second one.
Yeah. So, yeah. I said, I tried to clean it up too. I didn't even use a bad word. I just said women.
You'd be a good psychologist. Is that what you do when you watch TV? So.
You know what I want to be, but I don't think I'd be good at it at all. But is a criminal profiler. I'm fascinated with that. I'm reading this book now all about criminal profiling. And, this guy was able to look at crime scenes, you know, and he's the guy they based Silence of the Lambs after. Oh. And by looking at a crime scene, he could tell that the killer had a lisp. Like, he wrote up a profile, and he's like, he's this age, he drives this kind of car, which is crazy to me. They could tell what kind of car they drive, right, you know? Right. And he was correct. You know, it's a lot of his old profiles of, you know, because he was like a serial killer profiler. And then he's like, the killer had a lisp. And he explains why, that he has come to this conclusion, and the guy does. And I'm like, that's the most fascinating thing I've ever heard in my life. You know, they can just look at somebody and be able to tell like 10 things about them, you know?
Wow, that's like in every control room here, there's a book that we've profiled our listeners.
Really?
We know who they are, what they drive, what they drink. And so what we do so that we stay focused as to who our listener is, we are consistently going through that book.
Wow.
And so we're always, and so when we go out into public, and that it's so inside our mind that we have to go out and shake hands, kiss babies, and do the promotional thing. But could you have nailed this kid who did this crime in Charleston?
He looked like a regular kid. Yeah, that's what's so distressing about a lot of those things, is they look like they could just blend in so easily, and it's just so terrifying and strange, you know? I mean, this guy worked for the FBI, so I guess that's what his job is. But see, a lot of times those guys come in way late after everything, you know? So
yeah, but I'd hate to be in that meeting and they go, you guys didn't see it? It was written on the wall.
Yeah, I know. God. Oh, life is awful and hard.
I mean, it's like your promotional shots. What makes you decide that picture? Right away, people walking by are going,
I don't know. They have one up at the club right now. Mike is in the room who runs a club. That picture is so embarrassing. I look like such an asshole.
Oh, no.
Yeah, these pictures get online. It's like me like folding my arms and making like some sassy newscaster face. I think I had to take it for like Last Comic Standing. Like, they had us do some promotional shots, but I didn't have any control over it. It's on, and then it just got released online, and I look like such a jackass. Yeah, I look like gay, everybody. Listen to me. It's my turn, you know? Oh. I see so many pictures of myself and I'm just like, oh God, no, that's out there with that dumb expression. But then it becomes like a poster at a club somewhere. Yeah. So every day I walk in, I'm just like, I just try not to make eye contact with my poster.
Do you ever feel conceited though when you go through a photo shoot and then you have to judge the shots and you go, no, you can have that one, but you can't have that one?
Conceited. Yeah, I mean, not exactly, because I feel like it's so hard for me to look at like or listen to myself. So it's the opposite. It's just like when I was a kid, I'm going somewhere with this. My parents went and we stayed in this like beach house in Maine, and they played this some sort of movie about the mafia. And again, watch, I'm going somewhere, I swear. And on this mafia movie, okay, I was like traumatized by it because I don't think they knew I was watching it. I was like up late, you know, and then they had this guy who he's like his wife knew too much, you know, and he like took her out. It was probably like some made for TV bullshit, and he walked her out to the gazebo and he was like, Marie, you know too much, I'm sorry, you've got to go. And she was like, God, no. And then he had this little cloth and he like chloroformed her. Yeah. You know, and he's like, shh, Marie, that's an offer. And that, I'm telling you that story, it's a very long road I just took to say that that's what I want to do when I like watch myself on stage. I want to Marie myself, like, enough. It's just hard. It's hard to watch yourself or listen to your own voice. I mean, only I think complete assholes just like love watching themselves, like, hey, what a gal, she's really up to some great things, isn't she? I see myself and I'm like, what did I ever need to say to the world, you know? But a lot of comics feel that way.
It's that little cryptic voice in your head.
Yeah, where you're just like, what in God's name? Yeah.
How many people live
especially
in you?
God, a variety of different voices.
and it's fun to be able to go in there and identify. Like, I'll give them names.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'll you know, and then if you're having a bad day, you know, you just, you know, I'll start calling them, you know, and cussing at them. And I swear, if people come in this room, they're going to go, here he goes again. some guy named Kevin he's yelling at. Where's Kevin in the room? In his head.
Wait, which is your most evil person that lives inside you?
Probably the perfectionist.
Yeah.
The guy that wants it right because
What a prick.
He is.
Yeah.
He's a total ass. And, yeah. And because I totally believe that listeners hear every single thing that you do. Like when you're at a comedy club, if you breathe wrong, you know somebody heard it.
Yeah.
When in reality, they didn't catch it. But yeah. Inside your mind, you're going, I can't believe that I took a double breath in the middle of that sentence. You know, it's like, what the hell's wrong with me? God, what was I doing? And you start breaking it down.
It's so true. Yeah. And then at the end of the night, you're just like, you're just listening to yourself. Like, why in the hell? But they don't notice. You know why? Because they're drunk. That's why. Because they're very intoxicated. Yeah. They're just like, oh my God. Kelly's bachelor party was amazing. What was that girl standing on stage making weird faces for? Like, they have no idea they were at a comedy show.
No, iHeartRadio is everywhere, so that means that people that are tuning in are going to find out who you are. Where can they find you?
They can find me on Twitter, at Rachel Feinstein, and Facebook, just Rachel Feinstein. And where else? Let me see here. Rachel-Feinstein.com is my website. I'll be on the movie. I'll be in the movie Trainwreck this summer.
I got that premiere coming up.
Yeah, I have a scene in it.
Oh my God.
Yeah, me and Amari Stoudemire.
So when I point to the screen, you'll be able to feel it, right?
That's
me looking at the stars. You know?
I'm a nurse, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I play a nurse. And I have a Comedy Central special that'll be coming out soon, too. And a Netflix special. You can watch me and Amy Schumer and Nikki Glaser and Marina Franklin. It's called Women Who Kill. And that's on Netflix. And I can't think of any more promotional things to say about myself. Yeah.
We're full circle there. We talk about CSI and all these crime shows, and she's in a movie, Women That Kill.
Women Who Kill. That's the thing. Everybody always thinks it's about women who kill their husbands when they look up the comedy special. It's got like a sinister title.
I love it, though.
But, you know, that's what you call having a good set in stand-up. But they all just think that it's a collection of women, like, freshly out of prison. Yeah.